This is parallel session 25 of the last session of the conference. And I think to give maximum time to our speakers, I'll go right to business. Our first speaker is Guilherme Motta, who is adjunct professor at the Catholic University of Petropolis and PUC Rio.
Thank you very much, Professor Morrison. Some warnings for those who are following the paper in the book of papers. I'll have to make some dramatic cutting for adjusting it to the time, but I'll try to guide you through this skipping of parts of the texts. The second warning is every time I mention Socrates, I mean the character of Plato's dialogues, never the man Socrates, the historical Socrates, okay? So, the title, Are the Phaedo of Platonism Life-Denying? I begin with the third paragraph, second line, first skipping. In the Phaedo, early on in the narrative, Socrates asks Cebes to greet Evino and also to encourage him to follow his own footsteps as soon as possible, in what could be interpreted as a literal calling to seek death, had he not immediately added that suicide is forbidden to men. As a matter of fact, this could be considered the first of Socrates' many statements in the dialogue that could be taken as meaning that death would be preferable to life. And this interpretation could very well lead to the wrong belief that Plato's philosophy embraces a morbid denial of life. In this paper, I'll advocate that such an interpretation is deeply flawed and can only be upheld if one systematically removes Socrates' assertions from their natural context. Aiming at the correct contextualization of Socrates' statements about death contained in the Phaedo, we must first of all bear in mind that they are made by none other than Socrates, a very special character, carefully constructed by Plato throughout his dialogues to be the paradigm of the philosopher. Now I'll skip to the next paragraph. If we are to contextualize Socrates' statements about death in the Phaedo, a second crucial point that needs to be considered is that each and every time he claims that death could be preferable to life, he's clearly talking about the philosopher. Next paragraph. The third thing that needs to be done in order to correctly understand Socrates' views on the matter is to take into account that what he has to say in the dialogues about life and its pleasures, and apart from mere speeches, to see how Plato depicts Socrates himself experiencing such pleasures. My aim here is to show that the combined consideration of these three points contributes to attenuate the force of Socrates' claims that death might be preferable to life, in a manner which also challenges the view that Platonism is a kind of philosophy intrinsically committed with the denial of life. Given the distinctive traits Socrates has in the Phaedo, even if by a huge stroke of misfortune, all other Platonic dialogues were lost to us, the Phaedo alone could provide with more than enough information to reconstruct this key Platonic figure. Phaedo's Socrates states that he devoted his whole life to philosophy, and as such, he thinks of himself as an initiated and someone who is inspired. At some point, he states to Phaedo, I read a translation of Fowler with a slight modification. And I fancy that those men who established the mysteries were not unenlightened, but in reality had a reading meaning when they said long ago that whoever goes uninitiated and unsanctified to the other world will lie in the mire. But he who arrives there initiated and purified will dwell with the gods. For, as they say in the mysteries, the Tirsus bearers are many, but the inspired few, and these inspired are, I believe, those who have been true philosophers. And I, in my life have, so far as I could, left nothing undone and have striven in every way to make myself one of them. Well, now I'll have to skip part of the text, in fact, the next two pages, in which I tried to give some passages of the Republic, the Phaedrus, and the Symposium to substantiate the claim that Socrates is a true philosopher, someone who went through philosophical training, which conducted him to a radical conversion, much like an initiation, which enabled him to acknowledge the existence and of the highest objects of knowledge and the value inherent in knowing them. Someone who, in addition to that, became an erotic man in the epistemological sense. So, saying that, I skip to page... I skip two pages to just after some quotations of the Republic I gave, where it says, "This conversion, which provides the intellect with the ability to effectively see objects that previously could not be seen, thus making the soul apt to desire them, is heavily dependent on philosophical education. It seems correct to assume that at a given moment Socrates went through a process at least analogous to this one, having acquired the philosophical eros and having irreversibly become an erotic man, that is, someone animated by an unstoppable desire for the highest objects of knowledge. The fact that Plato used such vocabulary of desire to refer to the practice of philosophy suggests that the proper objects of philosophy, the objects that are perceived only through pure thinking, occupy the summit of the hierarchy of values to a philosopher." Then I'll skip to the second line of next paragraph. "If on the one hand, such objects occupy the summit of the philosopher's hierarchy of value, on the other hand, they constitute a source of pleasure to him. On this particular, Plato in the Republic makes Socrates assert that if the soul has three parts, there must be also three forms of pleasure and of desire linked to it. It must then be acknowledged the existence of a specific pleasure belonging to the rational element of the soul. However, in addition to the mere statement of its existence, Socrates goes on to build an elaborate defense of the idea that the very special pleasure inherent to philosophical life is the greatest there is." I'll have also to skip this quotations and go to next paragraph. "Now, as every desire is inclined to good, it's only natural for the philosopher's desires to be turned preferably towards the objects he considers to be among us the greatest goods, and I believe I can say now, to the greatest pleasures. This does not mean, of course, that other things which are in some way good and sources of pleasures are not also desired. And among these, of course, are included goods pertaining to sensation, goods which are felt as sensory pleasures and are experienced through the body, some of which are simply unavoidable to all corporeal beings, and whose nature makes Plato relate them to what he calls necessary desires. Given all this, death in the context of the Phaedo means the separation of body and soul, a process which, in which the soul is not annihilated. It amounts to a liberation from the less hindrances to the full and continued enjoyment of the goods that Plato considers to be the greatest one, namely the goods related to pure thinking. Therefore, in that sense, and only in that sense, death would be preferable to life. Even so, it's necessary to point out that it holds good only to those who share with Socrates all the above mentioned features. Namely, being a true philosopher, that is, someone who went through a radical conversion that is much like an initiation, having gained the capacity to acknowledge the existence of the highest objects of knowledge and the value inherent in knowing them, someone who, in addition to that, finds in philosophical contemplation the greatest of pleasures. Having made all these specifications, we must add that it would be still a mistake not to consider that the words death and life in the context of the Phaedo must be understood with an important qualification. Death signifies, in this case, a life of unrestricted thinking, which makes it a form of life, namely the life of pure contemplation that the soul can enjoy without the body. And life, in the sentence, death is preferable to life, also means, of course, life, but a life which lacks the complete fruition of the greatest goods, the goods of the intellect, of which even the philosopher has a limited access during his corporeal existence. So now I will skip to the third paragraph of page 708. Right in by the end of the page. One must take a closer look at an important distinction contained in the Corpus Platonicum, one which deals with the types of desires and their respective pleasures. This is a distinction between necessary and unnecessary desires, the understanding of which is crucial to grasping the admixture of contemplation and bodily pleasures which defines the philosopher's life. Concerning the necessary desires, Socrates claims in the Republic, I quote, "Well, then, desires that we cannot divert or suppress may be probably called necessary, and likewise, those whose satisfaction is beneficial to us, may they not? For the nature compels us to seek their satisfaction. Is not that so?" I'll skip the quotation about unnecessary desires. The necessary desires are, therefore, those strictly related to the preservation of life and those that one cannot suppress, while the necessary desires are the ones which aim at superfluous pleasures or desires and whose strength can lead to rampant impulses, harmful disturbance, and even sickness, both to the philosopher and to the non-philosopher. Indeed, Socrates adds that they are harmful to body and soul, common sense, and continence. This is a fundamental point. A life of excessive pleasure and devoted to satisfying unnecessary desires is not good neither to the philosopher nor to the non-philosopher. However, the existence of the body is still an undeniable fact, and it entails the existence of pleasures linked to the necessary desires that both philosopher and non-philosopher must necessarily experience. I'll skip that paragraph and go to the next one. It should be stressed that there is nothing in the Platonic dialogues to possibly suggest that bodily necessary pleasure is an evil in itself. Rather, such a pleasure seems to be a good, which, if enjoyed in moderation, should be even celebrated, be by the ordinary man or by the philosopher. I'll have to skip another paragraph. A good illustration of this attitude of celebration of life and its pleasures can be seen in the Republic, when Plato describes the way of life of the so-called sane or healthy city. Socrates says, I'll go to the second quotation due to time. In the Republic, I quote, "I forgot that they will have relishes, salt, of course, and olives, and cheese, and onions, and greens, the sort of things they boil in the country, they will boil up together. But for dessert, they will serve them figs and chickpeas and beans, and they will toast myrtle berries and acorns before the fire, washing them down with moderate potations, and so, living in peace and health, they will probably die in old age and hand on a like life to their offspring." There's nothing morbid or life-denying in the life of the inhabitants of the city made out of logos. And the philosopher kings, of course, by taking part in the city's way of life, will not refrain from the enjoyment of necessary pleasures which constitute bodily life in there. The bodily pleasures will be enjoyed by the philosophers until the very last moment they possess bodies. That's quite clear, by what Socrates says in the Phaedo at the final moments of his life. He makes comments on the unavoidable pleasure he feels in being unchained, and surely there is not a trace of avoiding enjoying such pleasures. But the most iconic moment on that matter concerning Socrates is, however, a scene from the Phaedrus, in which Socrates compliments the title character for the excellent choice of setting for their conversation. Socrates says, and I quote, "By Hera, it's a charming resting place." Well, I'll skip to the end of the quotation, just not to be so long, the middle. "Then, again, if you please, how lovely and perfectly charming the breeziness of the place is. And it resounds with the shrill summer music of the quarrels of cicadas. But the most delightful thing of all is the grass, as it grows on gentle slope, thick enough to be just right when you lay your head on it." It's hard not to see in this passage a clear proof that a philosopher, while endowed with a body, will not cease to be affected by the pleasures that necessarily result from his corporeal condition, and will also enjoy them. When Socrates states in the Phaedo that the philosopher's pure soul is prepared to die since it never kept voluntary trade with the body, he can only be referring to the voluntary search for unnecessary pleasures, or even the overestimation of the necessary ones. And the reason why the philosopher does not overestimate even the pleasant experience of necessary pleasures lies in the simple fact that he has already acquired a capacity to discover other goods greater and more worthy of being desired, goods that constitute a source of superior pleasure. When all that is taken into account, to simply accuse Plato of being morbid, of life-denying for having put in Socrates' mouth some of the speeches contained in the Phaedo, would amount in a certain way to a spiritual provincialism, for it implies undervaluating or even ignoring the good that it's proper to contemplate contemplative life, and also the pleasure that results from it, even when Plato has insistently depicted it. In addition to that, such an attitude also implies deflating the extraordinary character of Socrates, and that in clear disregard to the text, since the idea that death is preferable to life can only be defended by someone like him. I'll now skip to the end of the last paragraph. "Moreover, given the right context, the philosopher's voluntary detachment from the bodily dimension does not represent a denial of life, but its affirmation, in that it represents an adjustment to the conditions that are required to the discovery and enjoyment of a dimension of life that is not per se available to everyone, but one which one needs to pursue with a kind of desire and a force that can only be characterized as deeply vital. This is precisely why Plato chose the word eros to name the force that propels the philosopher and makes philosophical life possible." Thank you.
Now we have time for discussion.
Thank you, Guilherme, for your paper. I just wanted to ask one very quick question. You know, some of the language about the body in the Phaedo is really very tough. I mean, I agree. I mean, the case you're putting up is just fine in terms of an equitable relationship to the body, after all. But some of the language still remains, to me, very strong. I mean, at one point he calls the body kakon. That's a tough word. I mean, it sounds as though he's actually calling the body evil. And I'm just wondering, what do you make of that? Is there some softer sense of the word kakon such that we don't really want to call it evil? What do you think?
No, I think it's. I think the word there means evil, but I think that in context, it's evil to the philosopher, to one who has discovered this other dimension of life. It could be evil only in this context, I think, because otherwise we would have to deny something that I think Plato wouldn't deny because it's obvious. Until you are dead, as long as you have a corporeal life, there are some sensations and even pleasures that are completely unavoidable, and they cannot be evil. I think that when Socrates feels the breeze and the softness of the grass, I wouldn't say that it would call it something evil that is hindrance from his philosophical life. Because one cannot lead this philosophical life 24 hours a day. So when you're not in that context, I don't think these things are evil.
I have a question. I wonder if...
If there's a certain tension in your point of view. You're trying to point out how the view of Socrates here in the Phaedo is not life-denying, and he's not so ascetic as the standard picture, in part because there are necessary pleasures, and we're entitled to enjoy them. But if we are to become as philosophical as possible and just enjoy the necessary pleasures, there is some room for maximizing or minimizing those pleasures that are in this category of necessary pleasures. And so is there some tension with the Socrates character in the Phaedo try to minimize the role in his life of the necessary pleasures?
Well, I think he will try to minimize. That's the point. But as long as he continues to be a corporeal being, there's no way to minimize it to zero. He will have to feel some necessary pleasures. And when that time comes, I think that he will even enjoy it. Because I take Socrates, the character, to be a unitary character in Plato's dialogues. And if in the same dialogue he can be the initiated and the man who can feel the pleasure of the breeziness and the softness of the grass, I think it's the same character. But I think you're right. He will minimize for a simple reason. He really discovered some other pleasures that are superior. Not because he's kind of trying to suppress this, but just because he chooses some superior pleasures. But there comes a time that you have to go to the table and have a meal. So what to do in this moment? Get a bad mood and say, oh, here I am having to eat this delicious food. No, you eat food, I think, and enjoy it.
Please. I find myself in deep agreement with everything you said in your paper, and I wonder if you perhaps can go even further in your interpretation if you focus on the eschatological myth, where there's this description of the true earth, and the description is at times very sensual. You know, there is an emphasis on the fact that the colors are more vivid, the shapes are more defined. Perhaps this is not the words that are used, but it seems that it echoes perhaps the passage of the Phaedrus that you quoted. Yeah.
Thank you. It's strange, but... Thank you. I haven't used this passage. I haven't noticed even this. But if you take the passage of the Phaedrus that I quoted partially, there's a reference to almost all the senses except taste. There's the smell, the hearing, the feel, the touch, and the sight. All the senses are there, and they are being enjoy it, I think.
Questions or comments? Okay, we'll move to the next paper. Our speaker is Marianne Koshkarian. Elle soutient sa thèse de doctorat à l'Institut de philosophie de l'Académie des sciences de l'URSS. Maintenant, elle enseigne philosophie à l'Université de Géorgie à l'USA. Elle est l'auteur de Platon et Shakespeare, Le langage et les fondations ontologiques de la justice, et L'histoire de la philosophie occidentale, tome 1, La philosophie ancienne.
Bonjour. Est-ce que ça marche? Comme ça? C'est mieux? Non, premièrement, je voudrais bien remercier tout le monde d'être ici et de partager dans ce plaisir de discuter ce chef-d'œuvre littéraire et philosophique, le Phédo. Je vais manquer quelque chose qui sont clairs après être discuté par les autres membres de la conférence. Je pense, est-ce qu'il m'a resté quelque chose à dire? Nous allons le voir. De quoi s'agit-il dans le vaisseau, dans le Phédo? Le thème est philosophe et la mort, ou le philosophe et la mort, ou le vrai philosophe et la mort, ou bien Socrate et la mort. Tous ces titres ne signifient que la même chose pour Platon. Le sujet de Phédo continue celui de Criton. L'action se passe le jour celui où la discussion entre Criton et Socrate avait eu lieu. Mais Platon a écrit le Phédon beaucoup plus tard, peut-être 15 ou 20 ans plus tard qu'il avait écrit le Criton. Et nous voyons l'accroissement de la maîtrise et le développement des idées de Platon dans cette période. La structure de Phédon est beaucoup plus compliquée que celle de Criton. Nous voyons un dialogue inséré dans un autre. Cette forme a été déjà pratiquée par Platon dans les autres dialogues, par exemple le Protagoras ou le banquier, mais c'est seulement ici que nous avons deux irruptions de la dialogue extérieure ou interlude dans le dialogue central, principal, intérieur. Cela a lieu deux fois. Premièrement, quand Écrate est très interrompt Phédon pour la première fois, après les objections de Simmias et Sébès aux arguments de Socrate sur la mortalité de l'âme. Et l'autre, après que Socrate expose sa théorie des idées, mais avant qu'il fonde la preuve de l'immortalité de l'âme sur la théorie des idées. Je pense que cette partie centrale entre les deux interludes est la plus importante du point de vue théorique. Et c'est pourquoi je lis la question du coq qu'on a promis à Esculape, à la question de la guérison de Socrate, des amis de Socrate et aussi même de Échicrate qui écoutait Phédon. J'ai dit que c'était le dialogue entre, sans doute, entre Échicrate et Phédon, le dialogue extérieur et intérieur entre, parmi Socrate et ses amis. C'est le motif qui les a guéris du peur de la mort. Peut-être aussi du peur des arguments rationnels, parce que Socrate lui-même parle de cela. À la différence de Socrate, Phédon est plein d'harmonie. En dehors des idées communes, les participants de ce dernier ont de même impulsions émotionnelles. Nous voyons aussi que Phédon, que Échicrate et Phédon aigris, qu'ils éprouvent le plaisir en se rappelant de Socrate. Et aussi la paix et le plaisir. Nous voyons, nous attendons la musique, l'harmonie, la peine et le plaisir que les écouteurs de Socrate éprouvaient. Et Socrate, probablement, a senti leurs sentiments. C'est pourquoi il a commencé sa discussion par la question du plaisir et de la peine. Et aussi, par exemple, si nous parlons de l'humour chez Platon, on se concentre souvent sur le dialogue le banquier, mais comme le plus riche en humour, mais ce n'est pas cela. Dans le Phédon, nous trouvons beaucoup de blagues. Socrate blague sur lui-même. Nous ne trouvons pas lui faire cela aussi souvent dans les autres dialogues, parce que c'est le signe encore que Socrate se sent très confortable parmi ses amis. Dans les situations hostiles, on ne se blague pas de soi. Le plaisir et la peine, cette musique, cette harmonie, le jeûne dont le jeûne Apollodore est l'indicateur. Par exemple, Xanthippe, quant à Xanthippe, sa conduite est déconcertante avec celle des autres. Et c'est pourquoi Socrate demande de l'emmener. Le nouveau moment que dans le prison, Socrate a changer son interprétation du rêve qui le fréquentait pendant toute sa vie. À ce propos, ce qui est intéressant, c'est la présence des hommes. Primo, Socrate dit que si Ésope voulait composer une fable à ce sujet, il aurait décrit l'animal a deux têtes, a une tête et deux corps. Mais aussi, nous voyons que Socrate connaissait les fables d'Ésope par cœur. Et troisièmement, c'est la transmigration des âmes. En parlant des âmes d'hommes sans valeur, Socrate explique qu'après la mort de leur corps, elles reviennent de nouveau s'enchaîner à un corps. Et, comme on pouvait s'y attendre, elles s'enchaînent à des corps dont le comportement est identique en tout point aux occupations qu'elles ont pu avoir leur vie durant. Par exemple, ceux qui n'ont jamais rien fait d'autre que baffrer, forniquer, se saouler, qui ne se sont jamais retenus, ceux-là viennent vraisemblablement plonger dans les corps appartenant à l'espèce des ânes ou de bestiaux de ce genre. Je cite toujours une très belle traduction du dialogue fait par professeur Monique Dupont. N'ayant aucune preuve de la présence de doctrine de transmigration des âmes chez les pythagoriciens et probablement les orphéens, maintenant je cite par mes propres mots le professeur Luc Bresson, son livre Orphée et l'orphisme dans l'Antiquité gréco-romaine, 2003. Nous risquons de supposer, c'est mon idée maintenant, que Socrate ait ajouté quelques motifs populaires que nous ne pourrions peut-être associer avec le mouvement religieux aussi bien qu'avec les fables des hommes. À propos de la doctrine sacrée, les mystères transmigration des âmes, quoique nous n'en connaissons pas grand-chose, sauf quelques mentions, par exemple, ceux qui ont établi à notre intention les rites initiatiques, nous avons ajouté que ce n'est que dans ce dialogue que Platon affirme d'une manière décisive que pour l'espèce des yeux, si l'on ne s'est pas occupé à philosopher et si l'on n'est pas parfaitement pur au moment du départ, il n'est pas permis d'arriver jusqu'à elle. Ce n'est permis qu'à celui qui aime apprendre. Avoir cultivé la vertu publique et sociale, celle qu'on appelle la modération et aussi la justice, n'est pas suffisant pour être purifié complètement. Cette vertu naît de l'habitude et de l'exercice, alors que la purification complète exige la philosophie et l'intelligence, autrement dit, l'aspiration à la connaissance. À la fin du dialogue, en exposant le mythe de transmigration des âmes, Socrate répète de nouveau que ceux qui ont réussi à se purifier autant qu'il faut grâce à la philosophie vivent pour tout le temps à venir absolument sans corps. Cela nous permet de conclure qu'ici, il s'agit d'un culte religieux et mystique dans lequel l'idée de la purification de l'âme par connaissance des essences des choses est dominante. Une autre question liée à la doctrine sacrée est la question de la différence de raison des vertus. Professeur Catherine Morgan et professeur Edward Helper ont déjà parlé, c'est pourquoi je ne répète pas ce qu'ils ont dit, mais l'idée développée dans le Phédon est qu'il n'existe qu'une seule monnaie qui vaille et en fonction de laquelle tout cela doit être échangé. La pensée étant un moyen de purification. Nous pensons qu'au temps de la composition du Phédon, Platon avait sérieusement adhéré à une sorte de doctrine sacrée. c'est-à-dire à une religion, philosophie sotériologique qui voyait dans la pensée, connaissance, un des moyens de purification de l'âme pendant son existence dans ce monde. Sinon, Socrate avait parlé de l'autre échéance, plaisir et la peine, dans cette vie, échanger pour le plaisir et la peine après la mort, dans l'autre monde. Par exemple, in Gorgias, nous pouvons l'interpréter cette fois. Et maintenant, la plus difficile question est la question sur la corrélation des aspects religieux, théologiques et philosophiques rationnels. Les points théoriques. Platon veut sauver à tout prix l'idée de la connaissance comme réminiscence. Seconde, c'est la théorie des idées. Mais ce que je voulais dire, et je n'ai pas assez de temps, c'est que tous les exemples donnés par Platon sont du monde des nombres. On ne peut pas, à mon avis, Socrate voulait dire que nous ne pouvons pas connaître les idées dans cette vie. C'est pourquoi nous commençons de là-bas. Nous commençons par l'examen de nos pensées. Ce n'est pas l'analyse des idées. Nous avons une autre voie de le faire. Mais Platon a l'idée similaire aux prises de Héraclite, de Logos, comme mot, raisonnement, concept, la raison divine. Nous ne savons exactement comment travaille-t-il dans le système de Platon, mais chaque démiurge, chaque artisan veut faire son ouvrage le mieux possible. Et le Dieu, l'intelligence divine, il a parfaitement réussi. Il a ordonné toutes les choses et disposé chacune de la meilleure manière possible. Donc, notre voie vers les premières causes est celle d'en bas à la haut, de l'exploration en réminiscence toujours plus profonde des concepts. Il y a beaucoup de questions. Par exemple, l'incertitude de Socrate qu'il est avancé plus que quelqu'un d'autre dans cette indigation des concepts liés aux idées, d'où viennent-elles? Nous ne tentons pas de l'expliquer. Sa méthode, celle d'examiner si toutes les affirmations qui, sur son élan, ont procédé de son hypothèse, sont mutuellement consonantes ou dissonantes, ne nous aide pas. C'est pourquoi Simmias a quelques doutes, il n'est pas complètement persuadé. Et maintenant, je reviens pour 2 minutes seulement aux images de Phédon. Je pense que le mythe de Phédon, ce n'est pas seulement l'antécédent du mythe à la fin de la République, mais c'est aussi le précédent du mythe de la cave, parce que nous vivons ici et nous ne savons pas qu'il existe la réalité plus haute. Les autres images, je ne peux pas les manquer, très impressionnant. L'agréable et le pénible faisant un seul morceau à deux têtes, l'âme dans le corps ou l'œuvre de l'appétit, de sorte que c'est enchaîné lui-même qui coopère de la manière la plus efficace à parfaire son état d'enchaîné. Le plaisir et la peine, comme s'il possédait un clou avec lequel il cloue l'âme au corps. Les signes qui chantent tout à la joie d'aller retrouver le Dieu qu'il sert. La parole erronée, comme une abeille qui laisse en ceux qui la suivent son aiguillon, et beaucoup d'autres. Et aussi, sans doute, la deuxième navigation dont on a déjà parlé. Merci. Héraclite et Socrate ont la même idée des logos, parce que vous savez dire quelque chose.
Héraclite, les pythagoriciens, ils ont avait l'idée de la somme correspondance de notre raison à l'ordre divin. Mais je ne peux pas dire, elle est développée plus dans les travaux derrière du Platon, par exemple, les lois. Mais c'est très important, spécialement envers la fin de l'œuvre de Platon.
Please forgive me that I don't speak in French. I would just like to ask you to expand a little bit on something you said towards the end of your talk, when you talked about that we have to envisage un culte religieux et mystique dans lequel l'idée de la purification de l'âme par la connaissance est dominante. Could you say a little bit more about this cult?
No.
Or have I misunderstood?
Je
and in that case, please this, set me straight.
Personne ne peut expliquer quel culte exactement c'était. Mais si, mon idée, was, je ne suis pas spécialiste dans la. La religion, dans la mythologie, mais mon idée was que Platon, quel que soit ce culte, Platon devait être engagé dans ce culte. Autrement, ce que Socrate disait serait de la même échange de plaisir. Donc, for example, in English, if we truly believe in God, we are thinking about our penance, pleasures in a way. If we are not the true believers and speak that if we enjoy too much pleasure here, we will suffer afterlife, it means that we do not speak but about the exchange of pleasures and pains here for the pains and pleasures more important in the afterworld. So c'est mon hypothèse, ça, ma intuition.
Okay, so fundamentally then we're to think about a set of religious attitudes that you see pervading the academy.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thank you.
I have a question.
Yes.
Vous disiez le problème le plus difficile de l'analyse du Pédon est celui de la corrélation entre les aspects religieux, théologiques et philosophiques rationnels des points de vue de Platon.
Vous n'en pensez pas
La question, c'est ici dans le Pédon.
Socrate donne une certaine autorité à une grève. Dans l'apologie, il donne une certaine autorité à l'oracle de Delphi. Comment unifiez-vous l'autorité de ces sources religieux, extra-rationnel, je dirais, et l'autorité de la philosophie du point de vue de Socrate, Platon.
Socrate croyait toujours en ses rêves, croyait toujours en tous les signes que Dieu lui envoyait. Peut-être plus que les autres Athéniens, parce qu'ils pensaient qu'il existait une liaison, son liaison avec Apollon. Mais à cette étape, à ce période dont je parle, c'est la question, une autre question. La question, par exemple, in Protagoras, nous pouvons trouver, nous, quelques idées que quelque chose existe au-delà de concrètes vertus. Mais dans le Ménon, c'est la théorie des idées, pas d'aspect religieux. Et cet aspect religieux apparaît à Gorgias et apparaît à Phédon et joue le rôle pas moins important que la théorie des idées. Je ne peux pas expliquer leur balance en ce moment-là. J'ai lu que le professeur russe Yuri Shichalin allait parler, il avait l'idée que peut-être Phédon a été écrit avant. Mais non, je n'ai pas lu son abstract. Mais je pense qu'il pensait que ces deux directions de la pensée différentes développées approximativement à la même période. Et il est très difficile pour nous de dire qui était le premier, qui était le dernier. Gorgias est basé plus sur la religion. Phédon, dans le Phédon, nous voyons les deux arguments, les deux directions de la pensée rationnelle et religieuse. Dans la République, la religion est utilisée plus, plus d'une manière plus didactique. Les arguments ne sont pas basés sur elle. Mais cette période, par mon intuition, c'est la période où Platon était réellement influencé, sinon le membre de quelques cultes religieux. Mais je peux être toi. Sans doute, nous ne le connaissons pas.
Merci.
Our next speaker is Brian Marab. He has a PhD in philosophy from Boston University. His dissertation title was The Law of Nature in Plato. And right now, he's an assistant professor in the philosophy department of the Universidad de Los Andes, pardon for the pronunciation, in Bogota, Colombia.
Thank you all for surviving until the end of the week. You'll find that, of course, by the end of the week, much of what I said will be said already, but as the Greeks said, dies kai tris dakala, and we might add kai muriakis an infinity of times. That means si alguien quiere hacer sus preguntas en español, en caso ya. Si se puede, yo le contestaré en Spanish. And last of all, it should be Socrates' demodes musique. I originally was pedantic and put the musique in the accusative as it's quoted, and then I dropped the N and forgot to add the S. So it's, of course, demodes musique. So, yes, demodes musique, mythos and logos in the field.
Brian, sorry, can you speak closer?
Thank you. Yes. Socrates, demodes musicae, mythos and logos in the Phaedo. After relating to Ocrates the reasons for the delay of Socrates' execution, the purification of the city during the embassy to Delos in the commemoration of Theseus' rescue of the twice-seventh Minotaur. Phaedo begins his account of the day itself and the extraordinary feelings he experienced, Thaumasia apatha, he said. On the one hand, no pity entered me, as if I were present at the death of a man close to me. For to me, the man, Socrates, appeared happy, both in his manner and in his discourses, his logos. How fearlessly and nobly did he die. In high spirits, Socrates was ready to engage in philosophical conversation like on any other day. For Phaedo and the rest of his companions, however, the experience was not quite the same. A simply uncanny, atopon, experience befell me, and an unaccustomed blend mixed of pleasure and pain. And all of us present were more or less of the same disposition, now laughing, sometimes weeping. When Phaedo comes to recount the events of the day and the course of the discussion in detail, it is Socrates who first brings up the theme of pleasure and pain. Released from his shackles and rubbing his leg to restore circulation, he reflects, what an uncanny thing seems to be that which human beings call pleasure. How extraordinarily it is inclined by nature to seem to be its opposite, pain. The two are not willing to occur simultaneously to a human being, but if someone pursues the one and obtains it, it is practically always necessary that he also obtain the other, as if, though being two, they were joined to one and the same head. Then Socrates continues with the remark that if Aesop had thought of this, he would surely have composed a fable on mythos, to the effect that some god, unable to reconcile pleasure and pain as they warred with each other, had joined them together so that the one would always follow the other. And it's at this point that Cebes interrupts to ask Socrates about the stories, the logos, of Aesop that he had apparently put to verse, as well as the proem to Apollo that he had composed. But before entering into a consideration of Socrates' musical activity, which is the main theme of this paper, it is important to make a few remarks about his brief discussion of pleasure and pain. While Phaedo had remarked on his own uncanny experience of pleasure and pain in a philosophical conversation with Socrates on his last day, and Socrates' own good spirits, Socrates himself uses the example of the pleasant sensation of the restored circulation of his leg. While Phaedo's experience of pleasure and pain refers to the soul, Socrates' is a purely bodily phenomenon, or primarily bodily phenomenon. Socrates, who appeared entirely happy on the day of his death, seems to suggest that the mixture of pleasure and pain is a merely bodily phenomenon, and therefore that his companions' experience, their emotional experience, is a result of their own insufficient detachment from the concerns of the body. The aim of Socrates' musical practice, and of Phaedo as a whole, I will maintain, is to encourage precisely this kind of detachment that Socrates himself already embodies. In answering Cebes' question, then, about his practice in music, Socrates recounts a dream that had come to him in many different forms in his life, and which would always tell him the same thing, that he should make and practice musique. He had taken this as encouragement to continue his practice of philosophy, since philosophy was the greatest music. But now, awaiting his execution, it has occurred to him that the command of the dream might have been to practice demode musicae all along, popular music, let's say. In order then to acquit himself of his sacred obligation, or to avoid the scruple, aphosiotestai, he has spent his last days composing poems, and considering that a poet, if he intends to be a poet, must make myths and not logoi, and that he himself was not capable of making myths, the word he uses is mythologikos. He had taken those myths that I had ready at hand and knew, those of Aesop, and put to verse the first ones I came across. Thus, while Socrates seems to strongly distinguish the logoi of philosophy from the mythoi of popular music, the two cannot be conceived as opposites, but most as poles along a single continuum, that is, musicae. If philosophy is the greatest musicae, and poetry is popular or demodes, they are nonetheless both musicae, and so must have at least something in common in terms of form, content, or intention. This is nothing more than what Socrates had already suggested with his account of pleasure and pain, and the Aesopian fable he had used to illustrate this point. It would be going too far, however, to say that the only difference between poetry and philosophy is verse and meter. For Socrates seems to say that the distinction between mythos and logos is the more fundamental for distinguishing demodes musicae from philosophy, the greatest musicae. But even here, the distinction is not absolute. Socrates is not, at least so he says, mythologikos, but its own, albeit brief, Aesopian fable about pleasure and pain is already an example of the interpenetration of mythos and logos. This etymological play is by no means accidental, for Socrates will immediately introduce the subsequent discussion of the immortality of the soul, the investigation of the beyond, as a combination of mythos and logos. Having suggested that a Venus, who had first asked Achilles about Socrates' poetry, would eagerly follow Socrates to death if he were a philosopher, Socrates continues that perhaps it is most appropriate for one who is about to make a journey to the beyond to investigate Dioscorides and to mythologe about the journey. Mythologe, to use a mixture of mythos and logos. Later, he will meet up almost the same words, agreeing with Chives that the demonstration of the immortality of the soul is very difficult and requires much encouragement and assurance, and asking, do you want us to consider these very matters by means of mythos and logos? The word is dia mythologomen, which I translate rather awkwardly to draw out the etymological elements, in order to see whether it is plausible or not that it is so, that the soul is immortal. If then the text clearly encourages us to make a connection between Socrates' practice of popular music and the subsequent discussion of the soul's immortality through mythos and logos, how are we to understand the significance of this connection? The implication is surely not that the subsequent arguments for the immortality of the soul are to be dismissed as mere myths, but neither are they to be taken purely as logoi, as rational arguments in isolation. Instead, I suggest, we must try to understand them as a kind of de modis musicae. But how does Plato understand de modis musicae? We could go to the Republic, where mute musicae is the first part of the education of the children who will become guardians. And someone not sufficiently educated in this art will become a mythologist. That's Republic 411d. The connection between music and mythology will turn out to be crucial to understanding the Phaedo. And it is possible to make this connection by turning to another musical clue from the dialogue. After the presentation of the recollection argument, Simmias subjects that this only proves half of what is needed, for the existence of the soul before birth does not guarantee its continued existence after death. Socrates responds that Simmias and Chives seem to share the childish fear that death, like a great wind, will blow the soul out of the body and scatter it, which draws a laugh from Chives. So Socrates, Chives says, attempt to persuade us as one so frightened, or rather, not as if we were the ones frightened, but perhaps even in each of us, there is a kind of child who fears such things. Attempt to persuade this child, then, not to fear death like a kind of bugbear. But we must do so, said Socrates. We must sing incantations, epaidin, over this child every day until you grow out of this childness, until you exepice it, until you grow up. When Chives asks where they will be able to find this incantation, this or charm, this upon us, once Socrates has left them, Socrates responds that there must be many good men capable of providing it, both among the Greeks and among the barbarians, but that Chives and the rest of his companions must also look for it themselves with each other, autus et allelon. For perhaps, he says, you would not easily find men more capable of doing this than yourselves. How are we to understand the epodoi necessary to calm the inner child that is afraid of death? Well, one place we can look to is the Charmides, where Socrates defines the apodos as a kind of incantation sung by doctors as they apply their drugs, their pharmaca. I quote Charmides 155e, if one sings the apode, Plato uses the masculine and feminine apodos, apodoi, apparently without distinction of meaning. If one sings the apode at the same time as he applies it, the pharmacon will make the patient entirely healthy. But without the apodoi, there is no benefit from the herb. It is easy enough to think of the ambiguous meaning of the pharmacon, medicine, or poison, as well as the pharmacon of hemlock that Socrates will drink. Only with the proper apodos, only if death is not feared, Socrates suggests, will his poison become a medicine, a beneficial medicine. The Charmides goes on to identify the apodoi with kaloi logoi, that will produce sophrosune in the soul, the virtue of sophrosune in the soul. And at least in the context of the Phaedo, it seems clear that kaloi logoi, beautiful or noble discourse, are to be understood not so much as simply valid arguments as the plausible mixture of mythos and logos that Socrates has already mentioned. This interpretation is further supported by a passage from the 10th book of the Laws, where, addressing the second category of impiety, the denial of divine providence, the Athenian stranger agrees that the hypothetical young man who denies the gods are concerned with human affairs can be compelled by arguments, tois logois, to agree that he does not speak correctly. And yet it is my opinion that there is an additional need of some epodoi muthoi, some charming, some incantations that take the form of muthoi. Of course, there's a great debate about what that means. Explaining or giving one interpretation of these epodoi muthoi, Helmig has written that their task is to make more plausible that which cannot be demonstrated rationally because it lies beyond the powers of human understanding. And the stranger's clear distinction between epodoi muthoi on the one hand and the logoi on the other is enough to confirm this interpretation, as far as I'm concerned. Platonic epodoi, then, will not run counter to reason, but they will make claims that cannot be fully confirmed by mere logos. And their task will be to persuade the listener in ways that are not purely rational in order to produce not merely rational conviction, but a certain state of the soul. In the case of the Charmides, Sophrosune, and in the Phaedo, a relief from the fear of death. Chebes asks where they shall find someone to provide them this epodos once Socrates has departed. While he does not seem to recognize it, it is clear from Phaedo's description of the emotional state of Socrates' companions that day that it was the figure of Socrates himself, as much as or more than his arguments, that kept their fear of death at bay. Socrates was happy and that encouraged his friends. And that it is the prospect of his death, not so much of their own death or death itself, that is the cause of their fear. They're not afraid of death as some generic thing. They're afraid of Socrates' death. Socrates recognizes as much when he reminds them that they themselves are as capable as anyone of finding the need of the podos, as long as they maintain the courage to do so, and that they need not fear his death because they may continue the search for themselves. If then the apodos against the fear of death can be found by the unaided efforts of Socrates' companions, they still require, so to speak, a second apodos against their grief at the death of Socrates. He must convince them that they are really capable of continuing their pursuit of the apodos, that is, their pursuit of philosophy, without him. For it is only their pursuit of the logos that can provide them with this charm against the fear of death, and they must maintain their dedication to philosophy even before the fear of death has been conquered. Before they can find an argument for the immortality of the soul, they have to trust in logos and become philosophers. Or, as Socrates will put it later, Phaedo ought not to cut his hair the next day in mourning for Socrates' death, but rather, I will cut mine and you these locks of yours if our logos meets its end, and we are not able to bring it back to life. This exchange comes at the heart of the dialogue after Chebes, with his counterexample of a soul dying after wearing out a number of bodies like cloaks, has cast into doubt Socrates' previous arguments for the immortality of the soul. After hearing this refutation, Socrates' companions were displeased and doubted the possibility of presenting any convincing logos about the subject, fearing that they were not competent judges and that such topics could admit of no conviction. At this point, Phaedo affirms that he was never more amazed by Socrates than at that moment. But I was especially amazed at him for this, first of all, with how much pleasure and goodwill and delight he received the logos, the objection of the young men, and then how, when he perceived how grievously we were suffering because of the logoi, how well he healed us and called on us as once defeated and routed in battle and rallied and exhorted us to follow and consider together the logos. What inspires Phaedrus' amazement is Socrates' cheerful reception of a refutation according to which his own death may very well be final. This reaction demonstrates more clearly than any logos that Socrates' first commitment is always to the logos, wherever it leads, not to defending a certain position. Thus, when he says to Phaedrus that their failure to bring the logos back to life and not his own death would be the true cause of mourning, he is not referring to his proposed proof of the immortality of the soul, but to the discussion as a whole. This is made clear as he proceeds to warn his companions against becoming mythologists, haters of logos or philosophical discussion. For it is impossible for anyone to suffer a greater evil than this, coming to hate logos, 89d. As misanthropy is the result of the disillusionment that follows a naive trust in men, Socrates argues, so mythology is the result of the disillusionment that follows a naive trust in logoi. In the present context, it is the all too strong desire to believe the arguments for the immortality of the soul that, in the face of objections, such as Chebes's, will turn to dismay and distrust of all logos whatsoever. Which will lead to eventually the deprivation of the inability to recognize the truth and knowledge of beings. They must all, for the sake of the rest of their lives, and Socrates for the sake of his death, man up and take courage, he says, andristeon kai prothemetein, in order to avoid the error of mythology. Socrates is especially concerned to present his own struggle. we've heard this passage many times, but again, it's worth reading again. For in the present moment, I run the risk of not being philosophical about my death, philosophos ekein, but like those who are quite uneducated, of being contentious, philolikos. For they, when they dispute about something, give no thought as to how it stands with the subject of the logos, but are eager with, that those they are arguing with come to the same opinion as they themselves posited. And at the present moment, I think I differ from these men only in this. I will not be eager that my companions come to the opinion that what I say is true, unless incidentally, but that I come to the opinion as much as possible in accord with how things are. Even as he faces his death, Socrates' first commitment is to the truth, not to defending whatever happens to be his opinion. Thus, he continues, I reason that if what I say, that is, the soul is immortal, if that happens to be true, it would be a fine thing to be persuaded of it. But if, on the other hand, nothing remains for the dead, then at least for this time itself, before my death, I will be less unpleasant to those present by grieving, and this folly, this annoia of mine, won't go on, for that would be an evil, but will perish a short time later. And it is so prepared that I approach the logos. As this passage makes clear, Socrates' philosophical attitude towards death is not dependent on his belief in the immortality of the soul. This is not, of course, to deny that he finds the arguments in favor persuasive, but that the outcome of this particular argument is not, for him, crucial to the viability of the philosophical attitude. This attitude consists in the desire that his opinion conform as much as possible to how things are, to attain truth and knowledge of the beings. If the soul is in fact immortal, then it is a fine thing to believe that it is immortal, for it is the truth. But if Socrates is in error, then death itself will soon relieve him of his folly. In other words, Socrates does not consider death an evil, even if it does imply the complete cessation of his existence. It is error or false opinion, and even worse, mythology, that is the great evil, not death. This philosophical attitude is the true meaning of Socrates' definition of philosophy as a practice of dying and being dead. This definition of philosophy, which draws a laugh from the song Simmias, does not mean that philosophers simply spend their whole life preparing for the death of the body, but is indicated by the perfect tethnanai, which implies a continued state. It implies a form of life that is already itself a kind of death, that is, a life spent in the attempt to gather as much as possible the soul into itself, autein kath autein, and separate from the body in thought. The purpose of this metaphorical separation of soul and body is the acquisition of wisdom, or phronesis, which is hindered by reliance on the confusion and imposition of the senses. The reasoning that grasps truth is most successful when it is not disturbed by the pleasures and pains of the body. Thus, as we live, the dissociation of soul and body is the closest we will come to truth and knowledge of the beings. Now, this description of the philosophical life as a practice of dying and being dead is Socrates' apology to his companions. For why he would not avoid his execution. And it's perhaps the best example of his interweaving of Plutus and Logos. So if then we can read this apology and thus the Phaedo as a whole, as a kind of apodos that combines rational argument with mythos, so as to constitute a kind of popular music or demodes musicae, we are left with the question, why Socrates' closest companions, and above all Simmias and Chives, who display a great aptitude for philosophical argument, are still in need of less than purely philosophical consolation. The clue to answering this question is the word demodes itself, meaning more or less popular or literally of the demos. The only other occurrence of this word in Plato is at Laws 710a, where it qualifies the vulgar virtue, the vulgar version of sophrosune, that unlike true virtue is separate from phronesis, and in which even children and animals may share. It is this same virtue that in the Phaedo is called demonteke, and which Socrates attributes not to the philosopher, the lover of wisdom, but to the lover of the body, the philosomentos. His companions demonstrate that they are still lovers of the body precisely by their pain at Socrates' coming death and their own fear of death. Further evidence for their continued preoccupation with the body is the myth Socrates tells near the end of the dialogue, which accounts the fate of souls after their death in distinctly terrestrial and non-heavenly terms. This further example of an apodos, cf. 114d, where the myth is called an apodos, which it would not be proper for any man with sense to insist on, relates that what we call the earth that we dwell in is nothing but a hollow or crevice below the surface of the true earth, with its true rocks and its true trees and its true animals and so forth. It is true, Socrates recounts, that those sufficiently purified by philosophy will live on without bodies altogether in a habitation still more beautiful than these. In other words, the myth itself is meant for those who are still attached to the body. It is not meant to be a philosophically complete account of the truth of the afterlife. Socrates' Demodes Musicae, then, is meant for those of a corresponding virtue, who, like his companions, have not yet fully turned away from the body toward the soul and to philosophy. And its aim is to bring them to just that point of neglect for the body and dedication to Logos, where this music itself, as in the case of Socrates himself, would no longer be necessary. It is meant to be a transitional step between simple popular belief and true philosophy. Thus, in conclusion, the Phaedo presents a number of arguments for the immortality of the soul, arguments which, according to Socrates, remain in need of more precise investigation, even after they have convinced Simmias and Achilles, that's 107b. And it's precisely the assurance of this continued philosophical investigation, not the demonstration of the immortality of the soul in itself, that is the ultimate aim of the Phaedo. As we have seen, for Socrates, if not for his companions, death holds no fear, even if the arguments for the immortality of the soul do happen to be refuted, in which case his folly would at least have given his companions less cause for grief. Thus Socrates bids his companions to give little thought to Socrates and much more to the truth, and to make every objection to his arguments for the immortality of the soul, if they find any flaws in them. The ultimate aim of Socrates' Demodes Musicae is, through a mixture of mythos and logos, to support his companions' own dedication to logos. His practice of poetry, which culminates in the telling of the mythos of the true earth, is meant to be in service of the greatest music that is philosophy. Thank you.
Thank you, I enjoyed that very much. If the Phaedo is meant to be a kind of popular music, where does that leave the status of the rest of the Platonic dialogues?
That's a very big question. I would say that one can... Plato does not use this phrase, Demodes Musicae, anywhere else, but I would say that you can find similar compromises between Socrates' philosophical perspective and the not perfectly philosophical perspective of his interlocutors. An example that comes to mind to me is that in the Gorgias and the description of punishment, where Socrates makes clear, especially at the beginning of the dialogue, that what he means by punishment, or the best form of punishment, is dialectical refutation. That's the punishment that is truly corrective and corrects the souls of his interlocutors. But clearly what someone like Polus, for instance, has in mind is corporal punishment. And so there's a certain ambiguity in the Gorgias between these two forms of punishment that I think Socrates plays on. So I think you can find analogous examples throughout many of Plato's dialogues that would be somewhat like the place of Demone Musicae.
Yeah, and if that's the case, I wonder whether one of the implications of your account is going to be that all of the dialogues are to some extent, exoteric works, that they're not really doing the job of philosophy.
I'm not sure I'd go that far. What I'd say, or I'd put it in this way, I'd say that all of the dialogues are meant to show Socrates starting at the level of his interlocutors and trying to suggest a way towards a more adequate philosophical account. That he's meeting them at their level, and he's never going to push them farther than they want to go, but he's always leaving open the possibility. And of course that possibility is especially meant for us, the readers, to ascend beyond the level of his interlocutors and perhaps come a little bit closer to him. So in that sense, I think.
This question could be a bit provocative, since I have been thinking for a long time about the question, mythos and logos. Where is the borderline? Is mythos deprived completely from any logos? How do you make the distinction?
Well, that's a very difficult question. As I suggested at the beginning of my paper, I don't think there can be a rigid distinction between the two, but yet they rest on a continuum. On the other hand, in many, many places in the dialogues, Socrates does make a clear distinction. I think he would say that he always aims, and I would say Plato always aims as well, to achieve a consistent, a coherent, a satisfactory rational argument and demonstration about the subject at hand. But that is not always possible, and in those cases, Plato or Socrates appeals to myths, and so we find myths throughout the dialogue where perhaps there's Socrates has an intimation, and wants to say something that he thinks is significant, but is not able to explain with complete non-metaphorical language. So I would say no, there's not a radical distinction, but logos is still clearly the standard and the goal that he always appeals for.
I would follow Catherine's question. How do you then explain the Socrates' distinction between what he was doing before and what he started doing? That, and so is he then implying that that philosophy is something which, you know, was unwritten? And that sort of connects to the idea that the dialogues then will be a compromise.
Yes, I don't want to make any claim about the historical Socrates here. I follow the first speaker. Did Socrates really have these dreams? I don't know, and I think it's a matter for us to interpret the dialogues. But the significance of these dreams in itself, it may well indeed presage Plato's own literary activity.
What I meant was that if he says, I was doing this before, and
yeah,
I thought that was musicae,
yeah,
and now I'm doing something because maybe I was wrong,
yeah,
and so if you're saying what the Phaedo is what he wasn't doing before.
Yes.
Then I think that's sort of puzzling, because then it implied that he wasn't, that it isn't the same thing as philosophy. Right? Is that?
Yes. Yes. And what I would say is that it's not precisely the same thing as philosophy. If he understood before, philosophy is, you know, going to the agora and questioning whoever he encountered, or, you know, the poets and the politicians and so forth, about their beliefs. Whereas he, I suppose what I'm doing is taking this anecdote he tells, which must have its own validity as an anecdote, as also a motif that can then be used to be extrapolated to the rest of the dialogue. So perhaps at the end of his life, he realizes, wait, there was an aspect of my philosophizing that was lacking. There was something I could do in service of philosophy, and that was to mix mythos and logos into what it was again.
One last question.
Thank you, Brian, for your paper. I'm sorry I was a little bit late. I'm really intrigued by your paragraph here. You say that this philosophical attitude is the true meaning of Socrates' definition of philosophy is the practice of dying and being dead. This definition of philosophy, which draws a lap, does not mean that philosophers simply spend their whole life preparing for the death of the body, but as indicated by the prefect Nanai, implies a form of life that is already a kind of death. That is, a life spent in the attempt to, as much as possible, gather the soul into itself, separate from the body. This passage draws, Katayama's paper earlier, where he separates these two kinds of death, right? The philosopher's death. The first death is, you know, the separation from the soul and the body, and then the second one, the practicing of philosophy. And here it seems that you want to put these two together, that you don't want to have two different kinds of death, that there is some kind of unity in that. And so I was hoping that maybe you would say a little bit more about that.
I thought it was in agreement with Hanajiyoshi. I would say that the death that that Socrates describes as this philosophical death is this, let's say the soul is turning inward to concentrate upon itself, to concentrate on virtue, on phronesis, on knowledge, and so forth. But this does not mean that one literally leaves the body. Then there is real death, which is defined as the separation of the soul and the body. And the two may have something to do with each other, and they may not. My claim was perhaps a little bit less bold than the other one, which is simply that it doesn't matter for Socrates so much what comes next. He says it would be great if what came next, I think I have pretty good arguments that what comes next will be an afterlife and immortality. But that doesn't matter for my philosophical practice now. On either account, I have philosophy, and that's what matters.
All right, let's thank our speakers, and let's celebrate the wonderful intellectual part of the workshop.